and the Ghost Coat Magazine video interview series from lockdown, whatever, continues as we welcome in the guys from Pulchra Morte. How are you doing today?
Hey, how's it going?
It's going well. We've got Clayton and Jarrett here. Welcome, guys. And congratulations on this new record. Very prolific of you guys to churn out these two records in a row, basically, and a single in between, and really a lot of activity. I wanted to kind of just take it back for a second, because it's such a unique project, and your approach to everything, I think, is very specific to you guys, how you've put this together, especially the new album. But do you want to talk for a second about how you kind of put this? I know the word supergroup gets thrown around a lot today with people collaborating and stuff, but this is a really interesting and collaborative project with obviously a lot of top tier people.
I think that I laugh when I hear people say that, because my life in particular is probably, you know, unique compared to others, but to me, it's really normal. We never really intended to put together a super group. It was literally just friends, you know, like Clay and I have been friends for a really long time, you know, and we obviously played together in Eulogy really early on. And, you know, it's literally nothing more than a friend calling a friend and going, hey, can you demo some bass on this? And then, you know, like me playing and like hearing the songs and going, wow, you know, this is really good. Like I want to be a part of this for real. Like I want to have some input here. I want to do this. And they were calling Clay back and going, hey, you know, let me, you know, I want to do this, you know? And then it's like, oh, killer. Well, here, meet Jeff. This is the guy that's writing these riffs. And it's like, oh, hey, how's it going, Jeff? You know? And then fast forward a little bit, it's like, oh, we need a singer. And my friend Adam, you know, is really somebody I've had my eye on for a long time, just watching his career as well as being good friends and having toured together and stuff. So it's funny to me when I hear that, because I understand it, of course. Obviously everybody in the band is super, you know, talented and has a history, thankfully. I mean, I feel really fortunate that we get to work together, but it's also funny to me in a way, because it just feels like my friends, you know? Like,
yeah, I think it's kind of important too that we get people that are experienced to be involved with this, just because we're so geographically dispersed that, you know, we can't fuck around. Like when we have the time to get together, we expect people to show up proper and rehearsed and have their inputs ready and, you know, let's go. That's kind of our MO. So it works great to have guys that are, you know, not only friends, but kind of veterans of what we're doing here.
I think I also want to throw out there too, this is something that I've noticed over the years, and it's actually been a problem one or two times. People have called it, you know, a project or this, that, or the other. I mean, there were some issues with some people that were working for us that referred to it as such. And I just want to be really clear that most bands, regardless of at what level they're working on, are working remotely. And I know this from the inside because I'm a tour manager in front of house for a lot of these guys. So I just want to say real clearly that this is not a project. This is a full-time thing. You know, I mean, it just is geographically separated, but to run a band is a full-time job. And Clay and I definitely spend a lot of hours on keeping this ship steaming forward for real. It's not a project. This is a real band.
Right on. And I'm so pleased to hear that. And I think when people get to hear this full album, they're going to trip, because this is, you know, first record was a nice introduction. This is some insane next level avant-garde shit. And again, I don't think you guys, you're not pretentious. You know, like obviously look, Eulogy and Wolfhammer and all the projects everybody comes from are really well-regarded and well-known. I'm a fan of both groups. I've followed you guys for a long time, but this particular, this new record is insane. Like, let's just talk about, first of all, when you were writing this material, did you envision this like insane Serpent's Choir of like 35 something people who are all, it happened to be like literally the best people in the world in whatever they do?
Yeah, it's kind of funny. It would be pretty hilarious for us to say, yeah, that was always the plan. You know, no, but we just, when we start writing, you know, we encourage Jeff, who's really kind of the primary riff writer, bringing, you know, the heavy lifting of material to us. And then, you know, we just kind of go back and forth between me and Jeff and Jarrett and follow wherever that song is going to lead us. You know, we don't really put any guardrails on it's got to be like X or, you know, it's got to be this, you know, whatever. We just kind of do whatever we're feeling in the moment and just kind of see where it comes out. And as long as it's good and is a good song, can tell a story and make us feel something, we're in, right? So when something, you know, kind of comes together, like the Serpent's Choir is a great example, where we were really in the middle of mixing the record when the pandemic and, you know, everybody kind of being put in quarantine, you know, self-isolation happened. And we were starting to do gang vocals for this thing. We're like, hey, you know, Jarrett had this idea. I'll let him tell you, but you know, it's why not get everybody, since they're sitting around, there's tons of creative people out there. Let's literally ask everyone, if you're at home, you want to get involved with this, since we can't come play a show for you, just come pretend like you're at the show yelling the chorus along. Literally everyone. We put an ad on YouTube, you know, inviting anyone. I mentioned it on a Gimme Radio show. We did it on our socials, just said, hey, literally anyone and everyone that wants to get involved can. So let's do this, you know. And then obviously, you know, we hit up some friends, folks that we'd known over the years that we really kind of wanted their specific voice and things like that involved. But, you know, we've got people that we don't really know, that they don't know each other. It's just literally anyone and everyone, like you're standing next to a guy at a show screaming the words, you know. It just kind of came together.
So I'll answer that in two parts. First of all, I had no idea through the process that we would make this end result, which I wrote recently, and I'll say it again. I actually, you know, listening to it at the end of the day, I was kind of pleasantly surprised. I was like, wow, that kind of exceeded my expectations. But I knew at a point early on in the demo stages, I was like, you know, I was kind of surprised. I was like, wow, some of this is really, really strong material. And that isn't really a gauge for the rest of the world. That's just for how I feel about what we're playing. Cause I mean, I'm just trying to create what I want to listen to. It doesn't really, the rest of the world doesn't really come into it until it's done. And then that's mostly just, I really hope people dig it, you know, but the creation process is really about us. As far as Serpents, I just was sitting here. Like I said, the world was kind of going a little nuts. I had just been sent home from Abbath tour. Like, we were getting ready to go out and we were sitting in Denver on a bus ready to go. And, you know, boom, everything stops. So I came home and we, you know, regrouped and did a little bit of work getting ready to start mixing it, finishing the last things up. And it was just kind of like, man, you know what? Like, that's never been done before. Like, what if we just invite anyone? Like, there's no prerequisite. Like, if you're able, then I want you to sing along with us. And it in a way, it was an experiment. I wanted to see how many voices I could stick together. And like Clay said, you know, I wanted it to feel like a show. Like, you don't necessarily know who's around you, but you're all screaming at the same time and it makes a gigantic sound. And you realize, like, wow, there's power and connectivity in this, if for no other reason than the music. And with some of the things that I see going on in the world, I think that some sort of like common thread for us all is important. And it being metal, being music, seemed like a good catalyst. So like, let's see what can happen. And I'm really, really, really stoked about the outcome. I don't think anything like that's ever been done. And I'm really proud of it. I'm proud that so many people took part.
Right on. That's a very positive and humanist thing to say for guys in a kind of black and crust death metal doom band. But you know, props. And I agree. And I'm going to say just one last thing on this point, which is this. What's amazing, and like you said, like sort of like a casting call, and you did get, again, I can't stress enough how many incredible people are. You know, Kyle Thomas and Ross Dolan in particular, and, you know, people like that. But then there's a lot of underground artists are also on here with those same legends. And there's also, like, you know, just really cool people in the industry for a long time, like Kim Dilla and things like that. So like, yeah, man, it's this amazing job on that. And it's almost like it's almost in a way, it's kind of like, I looked at the list and I was like, if you didn't know what kind of band this was, you might, and you didn't know some of these names, you might think this was like Devin Townsend's call list, right? Because it's insane. you know.
Well, you know, it was really important too for us to get some you know, continuity from where we came from, right? So somebody like, you know, Blaine Accüsed being on here, that's somebody we grew up listening to, you know, and it's a huge honor to have him now participate in something we're doing, you know, years later. And, you know, like Ross, you know, we chewed some of the same dirt early on, right? So just having some of that continuity is kind of a through line, bringing people into, you know, sort of our life story that we're telling in this music.
Word. I was going to say, in a way, it's kind of like, I think, a callback to how much respect Eulogy also had that, you know, aside from the people that came to you through internet and interwebs magic, you know, obviously these people respect you back, who you also want to work with. So I'm sure it's very gratifying.
Yeah, it's very cool. Very cool.
And then in terms of the rest of the album, man, it's just a very, you know, deep and diverse album. And you guys kind of, and you did this on the first record too, just shift kind of very seamlessly back and forth between these, you know, sort of, you know, blend this style of music together well. It's not like jarring when some bands put part, this is the black metal part, this is the crust part, this is the DB part. And you guys don't have any of that. It's just very natural. And I like, there's very neat transitions, and it's not like patched together oddly. You know, sometimes you hear things, you're like, why did they do that? But not here. Right. I really enjoy the whole record, like, holds up, you know?
Thanks for that, man. You know, it's, like I said earlier, we just really focus on trying to write complete songs. You know, having great riffs is one thing, and there's a lot of guys that can write great riffs, but it just feels like, you know, a lot of times the forethought of the overarching song is kind of left by the wayside. So that's really our entry point, is we're going to write what we think are good songs that make us feel something, that, you know, maybe there's a hook that you're nodding your head to, or whatever it is. You know, having individual great parts is cool, but we want to write something where the sum is kind of greater than the parts.
You get kind of in the weeds sometimes when I plan to do these interviews. So it's like, oh, you know, Latin title band, Latin title, album title, interesting album, you know, song titles. I'm still a person that no matter how brutal the vocals are, I try to pick out lyrics. I try to, like, get a vibe for story, no matter how heavy the vocals are or sometimes indecipherable. Adam is great at his clarity, right, which is a trademark of his, actually, that I think a lot of people could learn from Adam. But I wanted to ask if there was kind of an overarching theme of the whole album, or something you guys are trying to sum up and present with this piece as a piece of work.
You know, obviously it you know, Adam's in a place, and I think even within our band we sort of interpret what the other person is bringing to the table. I mean, I know, not now, but I did know the lyrics at the time when I was tracking them, and I felt like he had an overall kind of feeling or vibe to what he was trying to do. But it's been really important, and especially where he's coming from, and he said it to me a few times that he really doesn't like to over explain. He likes the person having the experience to kind of take, you know, whatever their interpretation of it is. I know that overall, when we sat down and named the album, I think I felt like most of the album sort of illustrated some of the human experience. I felt like some of it in its own way was sort of a call to caution about the kind of the state of things, and to remember the old ways. And I remember the human intellect and its ability to grow, its ability to understand, its ability to perceive, and the fact that, you know, I mean, like an ocean, we barely know what our minds can do. And I think that's always a theme. I think that there's some shedding light on some darkness, on some things he's seen in life, maybe as a cautionary tale. And I mean, I know for a fact that the second to the last song of the album, Locust Humanity, is based on something I wrote, which is essentially the notion that, you know, there's a really good chance that we're kind of a failed experiment. You know, that we're, you know, no different than, say, termites or ants that, you know, chew wood and then make houses out of excretion. You know, we coat the planet with concrete. You know, I mean, not, you know, to get all environmentalist on you, but, you know, that maybe we are just a wretched creature that our, you know, creators want nothing to do with, that they're sort of standing back and, like, watching in horror at what we are, you know. So, I mean, I know that's what that one was about. I think our themes are the same though, you know, taking a look at the darkness regardless, you know, and I mean, I'm always, you know, kind of have that underlying tone of, you know, expanding your mind, go outside and look, don't just deal with what you're shown on a screen, that kind of stuff, you know?
Yeah. And as far as the Latin, you know, it's not, it wasn't really an intentional gimmick. The only thing where we intentionally kind of looked that way was when we were coming up with a name for the band, trying to describe what we wanted to do, which was, you know, write beautiful music, but also kind of deal with the realities of death, you know, not like a cartoony sort of comic book type of death, but, you know, kind of the realities of living with those types of emotions, you know, and kind of hinting, I guess, not hinting, but sort of sledgehammering you over the head that from the very beginning, this isn't going to be a very straightforward thing, right? There's some certain degree of esotericness to what we're doing. So Pulchra Morte as the band name kind of fit. And then, you know, naming the first album, we pulled some of the lyrics that Heather sang on Soul Stench, you know, Godless and Divine. It just really fit what we were doing and wanted to kind of put forth. This album, it was really interesting how it happened. We started kicking around the cover art and kind of what our options were going to be there, where we wanted to go with it. And Adam brought up an artist he'd worked with before, you know, Brian Sheehan, who'd done, I think, the Wolfhammer cover with Adam and a couple other things. Started talking to Brian and looking at what he had out there and came across a piece that I thought was really striking. And I'm like, wow, what's this? And I look at it and Brian had titled it Ex Rosa Ceremonia, which was really just sort of synchronicity, because at that point we already had a song called that. So we're like, all right, well, obviously this is coming together the way it's supposed to. So that's kind of the route we went there. You know, it's not a gimmick like, hey, we're going to be the Latin band, you know, or whatever. It just sort of happens that way, you know.
I think Ghost has you beat already anyway. Don't feel bad. And and I'm sure those guys are not really on your radar anyway, but anywho, awesome answers, you guys. Thank you so much for sharing that. Not easy to talk about all these things. I really appreciate it, getting into the weeds of thought process and things you did like years ago, coming up with this band and creating this album, I'm sure well over a year ago. And you know, obviously you could not predict, although I feel like I've said this before, a lot of death and black metal bands have predicted plagues and all famine and the end of the earth, but 2020, as you would. But obviously you couldn't know that there wasn't going to be shows. I'm sure you guys were planning something. I know it's, like you said, hard to pull together this disparate talent, but were you guys planning to do obviously some touring and maybe play this completely as a piece live? Because I think it would be great live as a whole concert.
Well, yeah. I mean, there was shows with 1349 were scheduled that were surrounding Dark Lord Day. We hadn't been booked on Dark Lord Day, but I think it was up in the air, but there were all the travel shows with those guys, since I basically am their tour manager in front of house. We were going to just do all of their on the way out shows, and that all came apart, you know. And obviously I've had, you know, a lot of tours that have canceled. So we definitely planned on playing, although I would like to say that we did get together last week at Earth Analog in Tolono, Illinois, and we actually did play the whole album through live together, and, you know, took some photos and filmed some of it, and spent 3 days, you know, regardless of whether or not we can or can't play shows, doing what we're supposed to do, which is be a band and make sure we play well, make sure that when the time comes that we're able to bring it. You know what I mean?
Very cool. I would love to see some live streaming stuff. I know it's hard. I know there's differing opinions about live streams and stuff. I don't think that it replaces a show. I think when we do get shows back, people will be thrilled to go back to shows. I think live streams are a good substitute, I think, in the future for maybe live albums, because we'll, hopefully the technology will catch up to how much live streaming everybody is doing will propel technology and platforms forward. But yeah, I'd be very excited to see a Pulchra Morte live stream, either partial or full album or whatever you guys can muster.
Yeah, I think we, like Jarrett said, we did some filming, we did some writing, some recording last week. You'll be seeing and hearing some things in the relatively near future. And then, you know, if this goes on, much longer. We're absolutely planning on kind of doing a full show at a proper venue. And, you know, it's, even though it's still two dimensional, you know, it's, if that's as good as it can get right now, we're going to play because we love to play. That's what we want to do.
Cool. As we start to wind this down, I want to give you guys back your day. Of course, you know, I certainly hope you guys are all well, and, you know, and your families are well, your friends are all well, considering the year and everything going on. But, you know, what have you guys been doing beside this band? You have other bands, you have other interests, hobbies, whatever. What have you guys been doing to kind of just keep yourselves busy, occupied? I can't imagine with the loss of touring, for instance, Jarrett, like, I'm sure you're, you know, this is devastating to your bottom line personally.
Well, I also own a recording studio. I'm sitting in it right now, and I've been taking this week's excess time to recap my console. So I've just been sitting here with a soldering iron, trying not to blow things up. And, you know, I print shirts out of my house, and I, you know, do small orders for people and things like that, and work on records and master when people need, mix, master, produce, whatever. So yes, the touring sucks real bad. You know, it's a little bit of a scramble. It's not normal because I spend a lot of time on the road, but you know, I mean, it's working on the band. I mean, I spent a long time mixing the record. So it, in a way, it was like kind of fortunate that things slowed down. So I had the time, you know, even though I obviously, you know, that you're not on the road, so you're losing money, but you kind of try to not think about that and kind of just look at the positive side of it. Okay, well, what can I do to be productive? And you do that, you know?
Yeah, I mean, as a band, we're constantly moving forward. You know, even last week when we were together, we started writing another song. So I think we've got structures now of four or five songs for the next record. I mean, I know you kind of joked at the beginning where that we're prolific, but I mean, you look back in the day, album a year was pretty standard. I mean, Led Zeppelin put out two albums in a year, right? So it's just kind of, Jared owns a recording studio. We're all very capable of putting songs together, and we plan on doing just that.
I really like this record, and I'm looking forward to much more from you guys and perhaps other projects you guys have in the works and other bands and stuff. I appreciate the positivity. Thank you. It's good to get some hopefulness and uplift, you know, for this brutal negative music sometimes. It's good to get some positivity when we talk about it. And so I really appreciate you guys. You know, X Rosa Ceremonia is out now on Transcending Records, good label and good guys. So, you know, Clay and Jarrett, thank you so much for spending some time with Ghost Cult. We always appreciate you. Best of luck. Keep safe out there. All that jazz.
Hey, thanks, right. Keith.
Thank you, man.